Welcome and thank you for coming on this very cold wintry Friday afternoon. And what a show it was to get here to our great school. Very grateful that so many of you were able to come. The Marilyn Williamson Endowed Distinguished Faculty Lecture is held annually to hear a presentation by the current recipient of the Marilyn Williamson Distinguished Faculty Fellowship. This year, that distinction is held by Professor Marsha, Richmond, Professor of History. The event also commemorates the memory of Marilyn L. Williamson, who generously donated over $850,000 to the 90th Center to endow this fellowship when she died. She died on February 19, 2010. She was 82 years old. At the time of her death, she had recently retired from Wayne State University, where she had a distinguished career as a professor of English, with a focus on the work of William Shakespeare, Renaissance drama, and British literature. She first taught at Brooklyn University in Rochester, and she was then appointed chair of the Department of English at Wayne State University. At Wayne, she subsequently served as Associate Dean for the College of Liberal Arts and Provost of the University. The University's Board of Governors gave her a Faculty Recognition Award for her scholarship in 1991 and ultimately appointed her a Distinguished Professor of the University. She was a patron of the arts and a dedicated supporter of the Michigan Opera Theater and Detroit Institute of Arts, Christopher Shakespeare Festival in Stratford, Ontario, and the Metropolitan Opera in New York City. She loved to travel the world. She was proud of her top 10 most solicited there at Machu Picchu in Peru with her son Martin and her husband Robert in the spring of 2009, shortly before she received the diagnosis of liver cancer. During her lifetime, she endowed a fellowship for the study of applied mathematics at Open University in honor of her husband, who served there as chair of the Department of Mathematics. Her estimates of endowed fellowships for the humanities at Wayne State University and the Vassar College in where she earned her bachelor's degree. I knew Marilyn Williamson personally. She was chair of English when I was hired into that department in the early 80s. And she was full provost during the time I served as an assistant provost and director of the humanities center. She was a very bright, deliberate, and productive scholar, and a compassionate person. I know Marilyn would be very proud that this fellowship that she has endowed has been able to identify such distinguished scholars. Now, Richmond is the ninth person to receive this fellowship. The others were Richard Marha for English in 2011-2012. Professor in 2012-13, Dora Hale from Art and Life History won it. She was a professor as well. And in 2013-14, Chef App of Art and Art History, and also Liliana Koga won it that year. In 2014-15, Reagan Hoopman of the English Department won it, and 2015-16, Tamara Gray of Anthropology, and in 2016-17, Jonathan Flatley and Jamie Goodrich of the English Department. And this today we will hear a presentation of Marsha Richmond, who is the current recipient
to be here today, and when Marsha first asked me to do this, the first thing that popped into my mind when she mentioned the subject matter was, wow, what an important issue, and an issue that does not get nearly enough attention to a broad audience. And I think through her presentation today, you'll learn about perhaps sort of why that is, why the story hasn't been more widely told. And I think a lot of that has to do with the complexity of the issue of endocrine disrupting chemicals. It also has to do with who we often look to as messengers. And I, in the abstract, we'll see a nod to Rachel Carson in Rachel Carson's book, Silent Spring, which was really one of the catalysts for the modern environmental movement. Pre-Rachel Carson and Silent Spring, we did not have what we know today as environmental assessments and environmental reviews. We were not looking at chemicals and drugs and products before they came on the market to think about what the potential harm could be to the environment or to human health. And so following along with that, and the very important research of Theo Colborn, and looking at, well, first of all, identifying the impacts that endocrine disrupting chemicals can have on the aquatic environment here in the Great Lakes region, and then looking forward to human health. Really, really dramatic stuff. I mean, we're talking about impacts to fertility. We're talking about single-sex species of amphibians and fish populations here in the Great Lakes. And so when Marsha approached me, I said, wow, what a great, interesting topic. And I had to admit that I had not heard of Theo Colborn and her research. And so that, I think, illustrates the importance of the research that Marsha is doing and why this is such an important event. And personally, through my work, I was an environmental law professor and clinician here at Wayne State for several years. And in our clinic, we actually looked at this issue of approval of endocrine disrupting compounds in drugs. So when a new drug is proposed to come onto the market, they have to do, drug makers have to do an environmental assessment. But what we found out was that environmental assessment could be completely waived if the drug maker said, they certified that the particles of this drug would be smaller than one part per billion once they entered into the environment. So once it passed through our bodies and through a wastewater treatment plant and then off into the Rouge River Charge River, if they were smaller than one part per billion, the drug maker could waive an environmental assessment and not have to do that important review. And what we found was that some of these endocrine disrupting chemicals they have an actual effect that it's smaller than a part per billion, maybe one part per billion, or even smaller levels. So we looked at that, we actually sent a petition to the Food and Drug Administration to have them change this policy, and ultimately we were unsuccessful. But the FDA did say, well, we'll take a closer look at this certain suite of chemical compounds, including endocrine disruptors. And that's just one small subset of how these drugs are actually, or how these chemicals are actually released into the environment. You'll hear in Marshall's presentation about personal cleaning products and all sorts of other substances where these chemicals are present and the potential harmful impacts that they may have. So I'm very excited to hear this presentation. I think it's incredibly important research for the field. And to Theo Colborn herself, I think it's well overdue attention for the important work that she did. Just a little bit more about Marsha. So Professor Richmond is a historian of biology whose research interests focus on hereditary genetics, evolution and cell theory from Darwin all the way through the 1940s, and women and gender in early 20th century life sciences. She's formerly an editor of the Darwin Correspondence Project in Cambridge, England from 1987 through 1993. She serves on the Darwin Project Management Board, and she currently is president of the International Society for the History, Philosophy, and Social Sciences of Biology, and co-editor-in-chief of the Journal of the History of Biology. And one section of her research that, again, I think deserves to be lifted up is the focus on the incredible contributions of women in this field, in the field of biology and the field of science. To go back to Rachel Carson, when she was first pitching some of her stories when she was working at the Fish and Wildlife Service back in the 1950s, she would often release her articles or pitch her articles just using her initials, because she thought that if the name Rachel was in front of Rachel Carson and it wasn't R. Carson, that perhaps editors would just overlook it or not think that it was serious science because it was coming from a woman. So and you think of the incredible contributions of Rachel Carson and Theo Colborn, and then oftentimes those contributions are, if not outright dismissed, they aren't given the attention that they should be because of who the scientists are that are going to bring forward that information. So with that, it is my great pleasure to introduce Marsha Richmond. And again, this is the Marilyn Williamson Endowed Distinguished Faculty Fellowship Lecture. And the title of her talk is Sentinel of Science, Theo Colborn, and the Discovery of Endocrine Disrupting Chemicals. So please join me in welcoming her husband. Theo Colborn was from that. She
Was Gordon the same year that?
One morning.
It's really too bad. I'm usually able to see. Yeah. So she's born the same year as Marilyn Williamson, which I think is rather interesting. But she born in New Jersey in 1927. Her family was not poor. They were, you know, middle class, but they did quite well during the Depression, years of the Depression. But by the time of the Second World War, they lost a bit of money because the food company that her father worked for was serving the military, and so he lost a lot of commissions. So she didn't really think that she was going to be able to go off to college. But fortunately, an advisor in her high school who saw her potential arranged for her to get a scholarship, a four-year scholarship to Rutgers University. And a big chemical company, the big Spangola company. And she enrolled in the College of Pharmacy. And it was there that she met a fellow student who had come back from the war, and the two married a couple of years after she graduated, and they settled in New Jersey. His father owned a pharmacy, and she they both worked in it, and ended up raising four children there. She says that when she was a child, she always had a great love of the outdoor, and that's something that so many biologists share with her. She was a particularly an avid bird watcher from early on. In almost every photograph you see of her taken outdoors, she's got her binoculars around her neck. She, even though she was working as a pharmacist, she went. She joined a birding club and was able to go. She says, stick the kids in the back of the station wagon and go. And it was through this birding that so many people also she became aware of some local environmental issues. Well, they worked about 15 years in New Jersey, and in the beginning of the 60s, they had enough. Theo and Carrie were fed up with the disillusioned, I should say, with the pharmaceutical companies, their advertising, and some of the side effects of the drugs that they were prescribing. So they sold up three pharmacies and their house, packed up their worldly goods, stashed the kids in the back of that station wagon, and went west to Colorado. It took them a little while before they settled down, but they finally found a very small town, Hotchkiss, Colorado. And we go out to Colorado in the summertime. If you know, it's in south central Colorado, and it's just on the north rim of the Black Canyon of the Gunnison. Really beautiful territory. So they bought a small ranch, and it's very near the North Fork of the Gunnison. They raised sheep for a while and did other things. Raise their children, of course. Well, Theo continued to be a bird watcher, and it was, again, through that and her membership of the Audubon Society that she became increasingly interested in global environmental issues. And if you understand Colorado culture at all, you know how people are very keen on the environment there, particularly in a lot of these mountain communities that have seen a whole century of mining and the destruction that comes with it. Interestingly, Hotchkiss is very close to Paonia, and just north of Paonia, at the time Theo was living there, there were four coal mines in the area. Now there's only one open. But they were having trouble with some of the effluent getting into the mountain streams. And so she began to get involved in a number of kind of local environmental groups there in Delta, which is the county seat. It was through her environmental activism, if I get off cue, please let me know, that she, her name was sent off to the governor of Colorado, Richmond, and she was recommended for some of the committees that he had to fill. And even though he wanted to put her onto a how she served on the Colorado Natural Areas Program for a number of years, and with which she was able to go to Denver once a month and meet up with other people statewide interested in Colorado environmental issues. Well, it was around the mid-70s that Theo and Harry began to lose the same interest in life going forward. And once her youngest child was out of high school, the two divorced, and Theo began thinking about continuing with her scientific interest by going back to school and partaking in a master's program in zoology at Western State College in Gunnison, which is about 45 miles east of Hotchkiss. It's a beautiful mountain in a village area, and when she went, she decided to specialize in water issues. Her thesis is rather interesting, I think, because you know, it's very difficult to figure out the chemicals that are in water. You could get a pull a vial out and you can't actually see the heavy metals in there. So she did an indirect survey by collecting stoneflies and then incinerating them and then running an assay on their ashes. And she did deep, was able to get a good reading on the cadmium and molybdenum and the other heavy metals that were there. So it's a very interesting master's thesis at a, you know, a fairly minor college. During that time, she spent summers at Rumble, the Rocky Mountain Biological Laboratory that had been established in 1990 by a professor of zoology at Western State. And it's in an old mining town that was a ghost town at this point. But he had recognized that it had a wonderful environmental and ecological area around it. And it wasn't just local people who lived there, but national figures as well. So Theo met a number of major figures in environmental studies at the time. She met him at that time. And she when she was thinking back on that time later on, she said, you know, I went back to school to become a Western water quality expert. It was time water quality rather than quantity, if anybody knows water issues in Colorado, she said, became a part of the issue. Well, while she was working in, during the summers, both with the, doing the water shop and school and then her own research, she encountered Stanley or Stan Dodson, who is, was an ecology professor at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. And he was very impressed by her master's work and suggested that she should continue her studies as a PhD candidate. I said, come on up to Madison, and I think he helped to arrange an assistantship and fellowship for her, so she had found the funding to go to Wisconsin. Wisconsin was a great match for her, because then, as now, it's one of the finest programs in zoology in the country. And there, they had a long tradition of focusing on water issues. And Stan Dodson was a professor of limnology from whom she learned a lot. But she also learned that she did a distributed minor in epidemiology, toxicology, and water chemistry. So she was indeed becoming an expert in water quality. And she formed a lifelong friendship with Dodson, and she learned from him, and he learned from her. I was pleased to find out from Donna that he switched to doing his own work on contaminants, having previously been in classical ecology. She graduated with her PhD in 1985 at the age of 58 years old, which I her scientific career. She had discovered that there was a fellowship available with the Office of Technology Assessment, which was a great job posting for scientists. They could do research for Congress people and about science and technology. And so she worked, for example, on establishing ozone and compliance levels and standards. And if you know that at the time of the late 80s, the ozone layer was really big. And she met a lot of movers and shakers in Washington, D.C. environmental circles, including the man I pictured here, Rich Leroff, who was still very active. And I'm hoping to interview him a little bit later. And he invited her to join the Conservation Foundation after she finished her fellowship. Well, it was in that context that a major sea change in her life came about. Because 1988, so shortly after she had joined the Conservation Foundation, she was selected to be a consultant on a Canadian project that was trying to determine the impact of pollutants in the Great Lakes area. And this was a great job. I've actually got the data. She only worked 6 weeks. I know how much she got for it. And she had deliverables at the end of that period. So it's not surprising to find her saying that she did very intensive search in a very short period of time. It was, I think, an incredible epiphany for her because the paper that I showed you on the right is a little bit rare, but I got hold of it from Dell and interlibrary loan, actually. It's the Great Lakes toxic working paper that she prepared after the end of this 6 weeks. And they had asked her to do, I think she was following 18 species and looking at 17 different characters of problems that they might have. And she calculated all of them. She, in 1990, it's interesting, I don't know exactly the sequence here, because that was supposed to have been a short-term project, but she ended up, I think they were so shocked by her findings, that she ended up remaining with that project. It's connected to the International Joint Commission, which if you know about, it's centered, between the Canadians and the United States water quality issues in the Great Lakes, established since 1909. It is headquartered in Windsor. And they submitted a report that out of this work that she had done in 1990, that was the fifth in a sequence of reports on quality of Great Lakes water. And in the press release that accompanied the release of that report, they say, quote, "The health of our children is threatened as a result of our exposure to even low ambient levels of persistent toxic substances. Human health is threatened, and consumption of certain Great Lakes fish poses a threat to women of childbearing age who pass these toxic substances onto their offspring." Pretty heavy material conclusions. The other thing that they did in that report is they designated, I think for the first time, areas of concern in the Great Lakes Basin, and we still have areas of concern today. And if you notice, there are a significant number in the area that's around where we are today. Well, in that report, the little typewritten chart that she had put in her 88 working paper was reproduced. And you can see the species that she was looking at on the left, and above the top, spread over two slides, are some of the problems she identified. So if you'll notice, almost all populations had experienced population decline in numbers. And many of them had experienced reproductive effects, eggshell thinning, wasting, and so forth. And she noticed a number of behavioral changes. I'll mention that in just a second. And That little grin changed the world. It also changed her life. She was very much a curious person, and she began thinking, what is causing these problems? So she thought, later on in a 1997 interview, she said, "I sat in a wonderful position where I pulled all this information together, and I sat looking at it, and I said, there's something wrong here. It began to fall out that there are serious problems, and actually population declines, population crashes. The youngsters didn't hatch, or if they did, they didn't look good. Birth defects. Behavioral studies began to come out. The birds weren't behaving right. Females and females pairing. The male birds not being territorial, and male fish with both female and male reproductive organs." Well, I'm going to stop now and provide a little bit of an overview of what was going on in environmental, the status of environmental issues circa 1990. Well, as Nick rightly pointed to, Rachel Carson's seminal work, Silent Spring, came out in September of 1962, and it too changed the world. It did indeed begin the modern environmental movement. It's interesting that her book was prompted by a friend of hers who was a birder, who told her about a massive bird kill on a reserve where it had recently been sprayed with EDT, and that started the book itself. Well, the EPA was created just 8 years after publication of Rachel's book, and DDT was banned 2 years later. So you could say that she really made her mark. But in the years since publication of the book, things had changed considerably. DDT was a post-World War II chemical that had been introduced in 1939 and used extensively by the 50s when Rachel was doing her work. But that's not the only chemical that had come into the environment. There's probably a whole chapter in this book that's going to be looking at the post-World War II chemical industry and the products that they came out. Because it's interesting, I hadn't quite realized that DuPont, for example, is now down DuPont. So here in Michigan again is the center of the universe. DuPont had actually participated in the Manhattan Project. It helped to isolate the plutonium that was necessary for the bombs. And they were asked by the government to remain working for the government afterwards, but they said they needed to increase their bottom line. So they began to look to a number of new products to grow their market share. And they, it's that point that they begin looking at a series of polymers. Polymer chemistry had been kind of minor up to date to that point. And they were very fortunate. They found chemicals that made their fortunes, i.e. billions of dollars. These included PCBs, Teflon, Scotch guard, flame retardants. And you can see that in 1964 at the New York World's Fair, they not only had an exhibit, but they had a musical, The Wonderful World of Chemistry. And I took this slide. It's on YouTube if you're interested in some kind of chemical ditties and so forth. So it's a big advertising campaign that they are launching at this time.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Is that your things to look at? Yeah, I'll let you look at that for just a second. So they did manage to make some blockbuster compounds, as I noted. These included Teflon. And it's interesting to see that Teflon was actually the chemical was known about in 1938. But it's not made into a usable product until later. Plastics, right? So plastics became a big money earner. And those of you in the audience who are old enough to remember going to see you graduate for the first time in 1967 maybe remember with me, and that just bothered me last time I was in, that wonderful scene between Ben and Mr. McGuire, who takes him out, you know, this young graduate's return from college, not knowing what the future holds, takes him out to the swimming pool, and he says, I just got one word for you, plastics. And what's that even? Plastics? And he says, yes, there's a great future in plastics. Benjamin looks amused and walks away. But it's not just plastics. A Scotch card is another one. And I was very pleased with my interest in women in biology and science in general to find out that a Scotch card was discovered by a woman who had to be an incredible rarity in 1952, being hired as a chemist by 3M. But she says apparently that she had been making some polymers with fluorochemicals. Someone, her lab technician, accidentally dropped it. It spilled all over her tennis shoes, and lo and behold, they found it had waterproofing properties that by 1956 led to the patenting of Scotch Guard. And I don't think I need to say any more. You know what that means. So, about 1980, the status of the environment was different. 2 decades on from Rachel Carson's work. Carson had primarily, primarily drawn attention to cancer as the problem with EDT and other pesticides. So it's not extraordinary that most ecologists were looking for cancers in the wildlife. But all of a sudden, a new worry came on the scene, and these were called persistent chemicals of concern. And it was interesting to find out that PCBs were not, they had been on the market and been used for decades, but they didn't actually understand what they were until 1972. And a Swedish analytical chemist discovered, after painstaking work, what they were in the Swedish environment and published papers. And then all of a sudden, a national and actually a global search for these kinds of chemicals because they were so readily available. They were everywhere. And the thing about them is, unlike something like DDT, where you just ban it and slowly, gradually, it disappears from the environment over time, that was not the case with these persistent chemicals. They found with PCBs, and anybody who knows, we've got PCB problems here in the St. Clair River. Once they get in situ, they remain there, and about the only way that you can get them out is to dredge them. And you don't want to dredge them unless you absolutely have to, because that gets them moving again, right? So these were indeed chemicals. The persistence, say for example, the persistence of Teflon, was a great benefit to housewives and husbands and so forth. But then there was a price to pay for their persistence. So that's basically the background behind Colbert's research that she starts in 1988 and the findings that then are published in 1990. As she wrote, she said, in recent years, cancer has reigned supreme among diseases which threaten humankind. Now we are confronted with the knowledge that more subtle disease and dysfunctionality outcomes occur from living organisms' exposures to toxins in addition to, or rather than, malignancies. So she's asking in 1990 for increased funding for this project. They don't know what's causing it. At this point. Yeah, I'm very excited because MJ and I are going to be interviewing Sandra and Joe Jacobson next month. And their work was absolutely critical to Theo's identification of the ulcerative culprit. Because the Jacobsons came to Wayne State's medical school in 1984, already having a program of work on contaminants and they are professors of psychiatry and behavioral neurosciences, and they were looking at, they were doing something unique. I don't think anybody else at the time was doing that. They were saying, okay, if we've got these chemicals like EDCs in the environment, are there human impacts for them? And they began to study women who lived along Lake Michigan and ingested a lot of Lake Michigan fish, and then asking what was the damage, if any, done to their babies, their children. And they found a whole one there, if you can call it that. By the mid-1980s, they had already published a number of major papers, some of which are cited in that 1990 work of Colborn's. It was provided an absolute critical key because they showed the developmental impact of these chemicals, even prenatally and the early postnatal period. So 1996, in a culminating paper of this study, they reported in the New England Journal of Medicine that children exposed to high levels of PCBs before birth had as much as a 6.2 point IQ deficit later in life. Never made up. Okay? So this work, that report that had been put out in 1990 was soon followed by a book. People who participated in this, they were Canadian as well as American researchers. Mm-hmm. They decided that data about environmental conditions in the Great Lakes Basin were plentiful but needed to be better organized and made more accessible to decision makers and the public. A single, well-documented volume would promote public understanding of environmental trends and help identify needs for new policies and programs. So it's still, however, this particular volume is still a scientific work. You had to have been interested in science to know much about it. But it was through that book and the publicity that it got in both the press and scientific journals that Theo made her first public national and indeed international attention. She was asked to testify before a number of congressional committees on this work. And in 1990, she testified that the inclusion of developmental effects when assessing the risk from exposure to persistent toxic chemicals in the Great Lakes ecosystem was absolutely necessary. And the following year, she testified before a Senate committee, and it's interesting to see how her career is building as the years go by. She is now a senior fellow at the World Wildlife Fund and the W. Alton Jones Foundation, which I believe is paying her salary at this point. So she's getting wide press, but still, she's not interested in herself as much as she is in finding the answer to the question. If it's not cancer, what is it that's causing these developmental disorders? So I think this is brilliant. At a time when those people who understand interdisciplinarity in the audience will know that she called together an interdisciplinary and a multidisciplinary group of both biological scientists and human scientists to a conference, a three-day conference at this beautiful center. I would have liked to have been there. The Wingspread Center in Racine, Wisconsin. And at the end of these meetings, they were absolutely convinced that they had identified a new phenomenon. And the next year, they put out a statement called the Wingspread Consensus Statement. And then the next year, she co-edited the volume of papers that had been presented at this conference. And it was then that the endocrine disruption hypothesis was first announced. They said that there were a large disrupt the endocrine system of animals, including humans. It was the first clear characterization of the concept of endocrine disruption. Well, again, Theo, like Rachel Carson, believed that it was important to inform the public about these dangers. And so she set about to write a popular book, not a scientific book, that would... Thank you, Nick. Keeping on track. It's out of that belief that the public needed to be educated that she published Our Stolen Future in 1996. It's an interesting story here because I found multiple drafts of this book in the archive, and it became clear that something was going on, and indeed, there were a number of publishers who kept sending it back and saying, it's still too technical. So finally, she invited a scientific journalist, Diane Dubinowski, who wrote on environmental issues for the Boston Globe, to join, and she was thrilled to do so. And she shaped it in the form of a scientific detective story. It really is a rather readable and remarkable book. And as the book was going into press, I later discovered, when I saw some of the original books in the archive, this little thing saying that with a foreword by Vice President Al Gore, it was a sticker that they had to put on the initial copies because it came so late in the production process. But it's interesting that they got Gore to do this. I mean, Theo ran in Democratic circles. She attended President Clinton's inauguration, for example. There's an invitation in the archive. And she knew Al Gore, but he had just come on writing an introduction, a foreword to Rachel Carson's republication of the 30th anniversary edition of her book. And it's through that book that I first became informed about endocrine disruptors. I attended with we went to Grosse Pointe for the first time ever in July of 2001 and watched her deliver a lecture there. And I didn't remember this when I started the project, but I opened my copy and she actually signed it. And I said, you know, there's something in my past, right, that's kind of prompting me to do this project. Well, it's interesting. The book is attempting, because let's face it, none of us know too much about the endocrine systems, right? We know about estrogen and androgen and testosterone, but we don't really know how they work. So she had the big job of trying to introduce to the general public how the chemicals would interfere with development, reproduction, metabolism, and so forth. I learned by interviewing her youngest son and his wife that the wife did all the drawings for the book. She happens to be a medical artist, and said Theo just told her what to draw, and she did it, and I think she did a really great job. What are these endocrine disrupting chemicals? Let's try to get that settled a little bit. First of all, they are chemicals that mimic generally estrogen, and they either mimic or they block, they attach to the receptor sites that estrogen normally would attach to and block it so it can't do its normal cellular activity. They enter the environment either directly through industrial discharges or, as they found with PCBs, even the Inuit in Alaska were arranged or impacted because they could be carried by the upper environment. She had to describe what these were. And another thing that she had to say is how very small doses could impact bodies. And another thing that, is the classic toxicology had always thought that the doses in the poison, pardon me? small amounts could cause, and it was timing. Timing was critical. At what point in prenatal development they were exposed. So the response of the public was pretty amazing. It became a bestseller, and it prompted regulatory agencies like EPA, National Academy of Sciences, Food and Drug, and other initial institutes for environmental health to start their own work. As Nick kind of hinted, and I will have to go into further detail in the book, even though they started out with great guns, thinking that they were going to regulate these chemicals, they ran into problems, scientific problems, and also problems with the industry. Some of you may know versions of Dow written by some colleagues of mine, Naomi Oreskes, who's at Harvard. They have shown how various corporations can muddy the water, so to speak, just by casting doubt on hypotheses or questioning data or research methods. And that's exactly what happened. For example, in 2009, there's an exchange that goes on in health environmental perspectives journal, and the company scientists are questioning the research methodology, and then the proponents are questioning the ancient view of toxicology that the dose makes the poison, saying, you know, you've got to change up the regulation. So there's a real dilemma here. I think that it's not that different from the sorcerer's apprentice, because whereas Rachel Carson had one thing that she could attack, DDT, then by the time in 1992 when they published their book, they had a little over 100 chemicals that they had identified as endocrine disrupting chemicals. And today there are tens of thousands of chemicals on the market. Not only that, but they're everywhere. They absolutely are everywhere. They are the backbone of modern consumer culture. They're in toys, flame retardants, cosmetics, not just pesticides and so forth. One of the things that came out of our stolen future was at least a focus on bisphenol A, BPA, and they could easily get those out of water. So that if anybody knows anything about our solar future, it's generally that, gee, I've got the BPA, my water bottle doesn't have it. But I want to end the talk trying to explain some of the challenges that we have with the current regulatory system that I think the industry has successfully been able to influence. Anybody know about PFAS? Well, actually, that's a pretty good sample. So maybe a third of the audience, a quarter to a third. Michigan is currently facing an even more dire threat to water quality than Flint. Flint was a point source issue. But now we're facing more dire problem because these per- and polyfluoroalkyl substances, the PFAS for short, then there are PFOAs, PFOS, Gen X, there are a whole family of chemicals, not just one and so forth. They're in all kinds of things, and they are in ground and drinking water. And I took this slide off of the Michigan government website because Governor Snyder, after Flint, decided that he better get out ahead of this issue. So there is a work underway, but it's interesting in the lame duck session of the House that they muddy the water once again. So there are major, there are major sites in Michigan. If you look at just four of them, Rockford has got shoes. They used Scotch Guard and that holding pond has gotten into the groundwater supply of the Rockford. It's a major problem, and Michigan is currently suing 3M to help them with the cleanup. Oscoda, I'm sure you've been hearing about that, and that is an air base where they just used firefighting foam on it, and the groundwater and the surface water is horribly polluted, and there's a no fish advisory there. Parchment, which is close to Kalamazoo, it's an old, that's that area of the state where we have paper mills, and some of the water there, last summer the people had to drink just like Flint out of water bottles, and now they're getting their water from Kalamazoo. And closer to home, Ann Arbor, the Huron River currently has a fish advisory, and it's all because of a manufacturing plant in Wixom that is making auto parts, and they use the chemical in their chrome electroplating process. Well, why am I bringing PFAS into the story here? Well, despite how well it has been reported in a number of newspapers, particularly in life, these chemicals are dangerous and we need to worry about them, but nobody's talking about the fact that they are endocrine disruptors. So I think we at least are going to learn here pretty quickly the impact. So it's for that reason that I really think it's important to do this project for me personally. It's not just a history of science and a woman in biology kind of project. I'm a woman on a mission. Because the danger that Rachel Carson warned about in 1962 was seemingly pretty easy to fix, whereas the one that Theo Colborn identified in 1991 was incredibly complicated. Because essentially, we're having to fight modern corporate capitalist system in the United States, a production. And what do we do when companies refuse to test chemicals before they go out into the market? So we become the game face. And green chemistry is in its infancy, as my colleague Dr. Rich knows well. I really wish we had at least one green chemist here at Wayne State. So, environmentalists following Carson have long advocated using a precautionary principle. But what do we do when it's too late? We're beyond that. As the public may learn from the new threat posed by PFAS, we need more sentinels and scientists like Colbert to warn about the danger of fooling with endocrine systems that have evolved over the long course of evolution. In 2013, the year before she died, Theo Colbert reflected on the current state of the debate over endocrine disrupting chemicals, stating, "As we evolved over time, the first living pieces of organisms are based on a benzene ring, whether it's in a plant or an animal. The benzene ring," she explained, "forms the basis of the more complex molecules, such as the hormones, that define an individual organism's health. We interfere with that chemistry at our peril," she said. "By interfering with the hormones that define human health, we're changing humanity." Colbert said, "I want people protected, and so do I." So thank you for coming today, and thanks to
great, well thank you. So we do have time for some questions. So what I'll do is I'll call on people and direct the questions to Marsha, and we'll go from there. Please give it some time. Do limit them to questions rather than the comments. We'll have time to chat afterwards if you just have a statement you'd like to make.
Marsha, thanks for this great talk. You mentioned the complexities. I was noting the reference to Wingspread, the great conference center.
Right.
You know that it's run by Johnson's Pact.
Yeah.
And S.C. Johnson and company are noted for environmentalism in corporate America, supposedly the green corporation. And yet the Women's Voice for the Earth has disclosed in that 2016 that S.C. Johnson's responsible for a large spread of the chemical galaxolite in 81% of Great Lakes drinking water, which has these effects, and no one knew.
Well,
and by the way, it's part of Windex, it's part of air fresheners, it's a scent that they put in for air fresheners.
Well, it's interesting. I've done a lot of research on Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory, which was created in 1903 and came out of a Carnegie endowment. And you may know that Carnegie donated a huge amount of money to science and education when he retired, in part to regenerate his reputation. And so companies do this all along. So it doesn't surprise me. It is a beautiful center, though, you have to admit.
I have a brief squib about the cleanup issue, but you didn't pursue it very much.
Right.
If you would, what consists of cleanup if, assuming for the sake of the argument, that you can identify the problem and get it out of the water, what do you do with it?
Well, I mean, for example, with PCBs, once they dredge them out of the, as they've done out of the Sentinel River, they have to go to a toxic waste facility, and they have to be enclosed in concrete often. And they are hazardous chemicals. So it's very difficult. And not only that, but I know with the, I don't know what we're going to do with the PFAS. We'll see how that comes out, because it's almost like the chemical that's used in Teflon. You can filter, and you can use the best filters that you have, medical filters that go through any kind of a rubber type substance. But it would take 200 years, maybe, of constantly running that filter to get, get them out. This is a really big problem, and I think we've swept it under the carpet. Not many people know about it. We just go along with our lives. I read this morning, and I can't help, you're doing these types of research projects, and everything you read, it comes in, right? This morning I saw where we're worrying about sleep deprivation, that it's a national pandemic and so forth, and I thought, I just heard a talk a couple of weeks ago at Moderate Wayne where Gerald LeBlanc came, and he was talking about how these chemicals can interrupt the natural rhythms, the diurnal rhythms of the body. And I thought, the sleep quality of that, and I found a paper that there may be some, these little things that are happening where you think, oh gosh, I'm just not doing something right, I can't sleep. Maybe it's not us, maybe it's what we're drinking or eating or being exposed to.
So I was thinking of a typical case, a very similar case, 1960 pharmacologist with a Southern University, Francis Kelsey, keeps thalidomide, a chemical that crosses the central barrier and crosses the effects out of the U.S. and in Europe, not the case. Where is legislation on this in Europe compared to the U.S. and is there a difference in the U.S.?
Very good question. And Ron is one of my great students. Pushes me in class and you too. In fact, Europe is more advanced than we are, and the EU is further along in the regulation. The woman that kind of got me involved in doing this project recently is French, and so she goes back, she teaches at Tufts, and she goes back to France quite a bit and talks about the regulation that they're doing. So they're having a little bit. But it's a different climate, and who knows about the kinds of lobbying that go on in the EU versus what goes on in Washington, D.C.
Right, I know. Some of the Kelsey's and the Carson agencies and the merchants have gotten up their game.
Yeah. Another one that I wasn't able to talk about because of more time is DES. These terms, right? But the thing that was given to women with warnings against the cost major.
So what's understood about the chemistry of what is an endocrine disruptor? Sounds like an going to be like a jigsaw puzzle where the compound that has the right fingers to fit into the endocrine system are the ones that would be suspect, but not everything should fall into that.
Yeah, and I think that's part of it, the chemistry itself. I think one of the protocols, and this is still something that I'm going to have to go into a lot of detail for, but EPA in 1996 was required to do testing after this work came out. And they go through and they first try to identify if a chemical is an endocrine disruptor. But it's not always easy. Linda Birnbaum, she appeared in I didn't mention the video that came out after it was only with Nature. She worked for EPA at the time. Now she's director of the National Institute of Environmental Health. And she just, the chemistry is complicated. And so you really kind of have to test. They found one substance that they had absolutely no idea. It was a platinum. The company, the researchers was doing something where it was very sensitive to estrogen. And then all of a sudden, they kept getting results where they shouldn't have. And they discovered that was the attractive fact that the company that they was making the test tubes had changed up the formula. And so the plastics that they were using were the different disruptors and messed up their experiment. So I think you've got to test, but I'll have to go in and I'll have to draw on my chemistry background and go into greater detail.
We've got time for one more. A wonderful talk. So I'm interested in Theo Colborn's kind of philosophy. And did she read Rachel Carson and how that kind of influenced how she thought about the world? And also, Wisconsin has its own kind of philosophical ecosystem. Bill Cronin and all these other thinkers, although Bill might have been there after her. I'm wondering how much Wisconsin, even space, kind of influenced her thinking of the world.
Yeah, I don't have a lot of information from her graduate days. She was only there for 4 years. But you're right, I mean, just like Colorado, Wisconsin is very environmentally minded. And I'm actually trying to get the University of Wisconsin to accept Theo's archive. I think it's an excellent place for her. The question is whether she knew of Rachel Carson's work. I held her copy in my hand last summer. And I was trying to find the slide, I've got 40 of the slide, where there was, as so many of the historians absolutely love it. Inscription, and someone had given her a hard copy of the book, and I'll try to find it, can't find it now. It basically it was given to her, and he said, this person changed my life, and for from one wonderful female biologist to another female biologist, this hack. Male biologist wants to pay homage to you, basically. And then, of course, there were sticky notes in several pages, particularly when she's dealing with some of the chemical results and effects on DDT. So, in terms of her philosophy, I think this is my hypothesis at this point. Unfortunately, her correspondence is very light. She gets everything by email. And although her daughter Susan has her computer, I'm going to have to work on seeing whether I can get into the program that she was using to get to some of them. But I do know that I think she consciously modeled our solar future off of a silo screen.
Well, with that, let's please give Marsha another round.
I'm going to show some closing remarks. I don't want to make too many remarks. you behind you for the conception that you have an opportunity to talk more. But I do want to encourage people in the audience, faculty members as we are, to consider applying for this fellowship, because our advisory board has been doing a wonderful job of identifying excellent scholars to the recipients of this award. In fact, I'm so pleased that some members of the advisory board are here with us. There is Professor Newman from Anthropology in the audience, and Professor Ash is in the audience. And of course, there are a number of former advisory board members, including Hiro Metish, who were able to call to be here to see what the, you know, the product of their wise decisions. Another thing I want to remind you about, those people who were who attended our conferences in the past, we are accustomed to seeing Jennifer Leonard running around taking care of many things and everything, and most things went, all these other things went well. Of course, Jennifer left us last year, and we deserved it to a better job, which we should be in touch with us all the time. So Chris was taken by Tiffany Bockridge, and I thought that she did a fabulous job in organizing this event. And if you agree with me, please give her a round of applause. Of course, she was assisted by the other members of the Humanities Center team, a group of college work studies and student assistants who come together to do work at the center. And they are here, Shemira Tennis and Kirea Puniam and Chen Chin Zhang and Shiera Solomon and Mira Zani, and they are in the background there, so please give them a round of applause.